Good morning.
Good morning.
Sorry for being a little late today. I blame daylight savings time. This is the one day we get a little extra grace, right? Okay. We're getting into Jesus' letter to the Church of Sardis. I know your works. So you have a name that you are alive, but you are dead. Did that scare you? I added that. I was hoping I would see you guys jump. Extra wake you up this morning. Real quick, by means of review, we'll let the late stragglers come in here. Morning. We are in, last week we started the promise to the overcomer. So we spent the entire hour looking at who is the overcomer. What does it mean to be an overcomer? Are all of us just automatically overcomers? I'll give you a real quick review if you missed that. Were you guys here last week?
I was.
Yeah. Nice job.
Yeah, I mentioned he was Zooming.
And Derrik, I mentioned last week that I put this specifically on here for you, and you will go ahead and have a baby, and you don't show up.
My bad.
A command that everyone keeps is superfluous, and a reward that everyone receives for a virtue that everyone has is nonsense. Mm-hmm. That's an intellectually deep, multi-layered sentence. And I put that specifically for you, and I just wanted you to give your nerd thoughts there on it, and you weren't even here. But
how'd you do? I'm just kidding.
I did okay.
You did all right.
But basically, it's saying that, you know, we are commanded to be overcomers. If we're commanded to be overcomers, we aren't all overcomers automatically, right? So we got to be an overcomer. And if we all get the same rewards, why does Jesus mention the fact that there are rewards? If we all get them, you know, why is it a promise to certain overcomers? So that's, we believe, nonsense. Are all Christians overcomers? Do we all get the same rewards? Okay, real quick, by means of review, last week we talked about we have judicially overcome the world and the devil. Scripture clearly says that if you've trusted Christ as your Savior, judicially you've overcome the world and the devil, but our flesh remains. We still have to overcome the flesh. That's becoming Christ-like. That's sanctification. That's the hard part. We will be rewarded for our sanctification or lack thereof. We live in this already but not yet paradigm. Once again, Jesus conquered. We are more than conquerors, us in Christ Jesus. We are kings and priests. We are experiencing some spiritual realities of that right now, but that we won't get that full culmination until the millennial kingdom with Christ, where we actually are ruling and reigning with Christ in our glorified bodies. But right now, we live in kind of this initial first phase of an already but not yet. We looked at some scripture verses that says we can still be overcome by this world and by the devil. It's possible for a believer to still be overcome by the world and by the devil. We have to be on our guard. We will be rewarded differently as believers, and I know this is something that's not really talked about a whole lot in church. We kind of all wish that we, in the kingdom to come, that it was just kind of like a communist dictatorship where we all get the same, you know, shirts and the same the same stuff. But unfortunately, according to Scripture, I see that we're all going to have different responsibilities, different things in the age to come. So we looked at that. Some promises to the overcomer seem to be universal in scope, but most of them, I believe, aren't and don't. And we'll continue to go back to those promises to the overcomer. But here's the bottom line that we came to. When Jesus is saying over and over in these letters, be an overcomer, Jesus is calling the unsaved to be an overcomer judicially. He's saying, come to me, get saved. You can overcome the world and the devil through me. Just come to me, okay? But he's also calling us in this room, those of us who are saved, to overcome practically, to overcome our flesh, overcome the world, overcome the devil, be overcomers, and that's going to be a daily fight. So bottom line, get sanctified, and as me and Derrik and T-Hood and a lot of people say daily, get saved, okay? Now, I know that sounds funny. You're like, get saved. Okay, remember, there's three phases of salvation. Past tense, judicially, justification, the second you trust Christ, you're saved, not guilty. Second phase is sanctification. When you're reading Paul, when you're reading anything in the New Testament, you'll see the word salvation or saved. You got to always look at the context that it's in. Okay? A lot of times, Paul's saying, get saved in a sanctification sense. Okay? To where you need to daily die to yourself. Be an overcomer. Get saved. Mm-hmm. I'm not explaining that very well.
Well, it's justification is salvation from the penalty of sin, where sanctification is salvation from the power of sin in your life. So whenever we're saying get saved, we're basically saying, like, don't let these sins have power over your life.
Mm. Yeah, we have a joke. Whenever even Christians come in the smoothie shop, like people that we know are Christian, will say, hey, did you get them saved today? Okay, saying, are you getting them on the sanctified walk? How many of you guys know there's a lot of Christians in your lives that aren't walking the sanctified walk? So, there you go. All right, let's say a quick prayer and get into... By the way, guys, we need... Derrik, this prayer has got to be deep, okay? First of all, my brain isn't fully functional because I'm kind of under the weather. But this stuff that we're going to follow today, guys, is deep, deep. I've got confused multiple times just trying to sort it all out just to teach you, okay? And you guys will see why. So, Derrik, this better be a spirit-filled, mind-blowing prayer, okay?
No pressure.
Yeah.
Father, thank you for today. Thank you for this beautiful weather. We just want to solicit your Holy Spirit as we go over the topic today, as we talk about the Book of Life, because we know that it's a topic that can be confusing. There's many ways to look at it that it's just not as clear as we would like it to be. So we just pray that your Holy Spirit will give us the enlightenment we need as we study this, that you will convict us in our hearts, that we can apply this to our lives and be able to further see you glorified in your plan regarding the Book of Life and its and its promise in the Church of Sardis. Mm. Father, we thank you, we honor, and we glorify you, and it's in Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Amen. How many of you guys want to ensure that your names are written in the Book of Life? And how many of you guys want to know it's there? And how many of you guys want to be sure that it's going to stay there? I don't know about you guys, but I do. Mm-hmm. Okay. So, let's get going. He who overcomes shall be clothed in white garments, and I will not blot out his name from the Book of Life. Okay, so we're real quick, by means of review, I shouldn't even put this, but we'll look at it real quick. He who overcomes shall be clothed in white garments. We've already talked about this. We spent a long time on it. Future priestly garments. Remember, this promise to the overcomer is in a future tense. We're going to talk about that, but... those priestly garments that we spent so many months talking about, there is going to be another revelation of these future garments, I believe, at the Bema Seat Judgment, because we see, when you study the book of Revelation further, we're going to see these 24 elders who are clothed in white robes, and they already have crowns on their head. Okay, robes are for priests, and crowns are for kings. We are kings and priests. So, with that being said, there is going to be something at the Bema Seat where we will be rewarded for our priestly walks. And we've kind of talked about that. My question would be, why would the Father or Jesus and or allow a carnal Christian in this life represent him as a priest in the millennial kingdom? My answer would be he wouldn't. Mm-hmm. Okay? So then you could get into the debate as to whether he was saved or not. That's a whole other issue. But my point is I don't think that if a Christian down here isn't walking a sanctified life, they will not represent Jesus in the kingdom to come. Therefore, they would not be necessarily clothed in the white garments of the priesthood that is to come. By the way, in ancient times, white victory garments were common. This is kind of a common theme over and over again. You'll see this white garment as a victory. We've already seen these future garments already, real quick, just by means of review. Revelation 19, verse 8. And remember, this is the bride. This is the bride of Christ. And to her it was granted to be arrayed in fine linen, clean and bright, for the fine linen is the righteous acts of the saints. This is talking about wedding garments, okay? Are the wedding garments the same as the priestly garments? I don't know. We'll find out. But still, there's this idea of being clothed in a clean, white linen. Notice Revelation 19, verse 14. And the armies in heaven, clothed in fine linen, white and clean, followed him on white horses. Guess what? That's when Jesus comes back at the second coming. The armies of heaven, I believe, are us. Okay. Hopefully, we're all here on this army in this battlefield. Not that we're fighting; we're just watching, mostly.
We don't get to fight.
It's debatable. It would be fun, but I mean, Jesus. It just says literally, Jesus opens his mouth and he wins. Oh. You know, yeah. His appearance literally kills the Antichrist. Mm-hmm. We'll see. But what's crazy is then there's another verse later where the Antichrist is actually going to be resurrected before he's thrown in the lake of fire. But things are deep. But anyway, point being, we talked about this. The word for clean there, these clean garments, Revelation 19:8 and 19:4, or 19:14 are the same kind of priestly garments that we've been talking about. Clean, Greek word katharos. So that was just for fun. That was just review. That was just me. I was putting those in there because I was still delaying getting to this. Okay, I put it off as long as I can. I got to face it now. Okay? Mm-hmm. I will not blot out his name from the book of life. Okay, let's get into this. Now, first of all, I want to make an initial observation. And this is one of the reasons why I want everyone to hear this while before we started this, because this is super important for us to completely grasp. Okay? He who overcomes shall be clothed in white garments, and I will not blot out his name from the book of life, but I will confess his name before my Father and before his angels. Okay, first observation that you have to notice right out of the gate is that these are, you get to stay today?
Next week.
Yes. Good, because you're getting to the most important slide here. Okay, so an initial initial observation, these are in the context of a reward, okay? You guys will see a lot of people who want to use this verse to prove something in their theology, okay? They'll want to take this verse out of its context, which we know that when you take a verse out of its context is a pretext. This has to stay in the set of verses, okay? Now, you'll see what I mean by that. This is in the context of a reward. Clothed, blot out, confess are all in a future tense in the Greek, okay? I love it when you guys don't believe me, because then I have to show you, okay, in the Greek, every one of these, you can click on them, parabolo, exalifo, exomalagio, all future tenses in the Greek, okay? Future, meaning it hasn't happened yet. It will happen sometime in the future, okay? So, notice that I have in parentheses there, most are millennial in perspective, okay? These rewards, what I'm talking about. Watch this. Okay, you guys will see where I'm going with this in a second. Most of these promises are millennial. So let's real quick look at all these promises that are listed to the seven overcomers in these seven letters to the seven churches. Okay, so for instance, Thyatira, when do we get the power over the nations? Okay, that reward will be manifested in the millennial kingdom to come. Power over the nations. That's when we rule and reign with Christ. Okay? You guys follow me? Clothed in white garments that we just talked about in Sardis. I said I believe we will be clothed in white garments before the millennial kingdom when we're at the Bema seat. You guys will see here in a second. Let's look at Philadelphia here. Made a pillar in the temple of the Father. When does that happen? We'll find out, but I think it has to do with us in heaven, in the New Jerusalem, in the heavenly temple. We get to the promise to Laodicea, sit with Jesus on his throne. When does that happen? Once again, I think that these are millennial in perspective. Okay? Are you guys following me? Millennial meaning when Jesus comes back to set up his thousand-year reign. So, with that being said, these promises, we got to figure out when does that happen? When do we receive these promises? I personally see a Bema Seat revelation for a majority of these rewards. You guys familiar with the Bema Seat? We're going to talk about it real quick. Real quick review. I foresee a lot of these, if not all of these, are talked about and or given at the Bema Seat judgment of Christ. Let's real quick talk about the Bema Seat. That's where we get spiritual gains. Okay? There's Jesus giving a crown. There's lots of crowns talked about. Romans 14:10. I love Romans 14. Mm-hmm. But why do you judge your brother, or why do you show contempt for your brother? For we shall stand before the judgment seat of Christ. The judgment seat of Christ right there, the Greek is Bema. So whenever you hear me or Derrik or anybody else talking about Bema, this is where we get the Bema seat judgment. And I love how Paul summarizes things so succinctly here. Whoa. That had to have been the Holy Spirit. I don't even know what that word fully means. But he's basically saying, why are you guys bickering about, you know, food worship to, or eating food sacrificed to idols, to so on and so forth? Why are you guys bickering over that? Why are you judging them? Not saying that those items aren't important, but what he's saying is Jesus is going to sort that out, okay? You guys deal with the other tasks that are at hand, okay? Don't sweat the small stuff, they say. All right, this is one of my favorite sets of verses. I guess you could say this is like my life verses as I walk my sanctification now. And it's from 1 Corinthians 3. Remember that The Corinthians were fighting. They were bickering. They were all saying, I'm of Apollos, I'm of Paul, I'm of blah, blah, blah. That would be like us saying, well, I'm of Pastor Block, I'm of Brandon. Brandon teaches me more. This pastor teaches. You see that sectarianism divide? Paul was saying you guys are baby Christians for thinking that way because it's God who gives the growth. Okay, it's the God who really does everything, not your pastor. Okay, so let's see what Paul has to say here. For we are God's fellow workers, you are God's field, you are God's building. According to the grace of God, which was given to me as a wise master builder, I have laid the foundation, another builds on it. So Paul's saying, I'm the first guy really to teach you guys the foundation. And he tells us what the foundation is. It's Jesus himself. Okay? Jesus Christ is the foundation of all of our works. Everything that we do in our Christian life, if it's not built on Jesus Christ and him alone, it's nothing. Okay? But let each one take heed how he builds on it, for no other foundation can anyone lay that which is laid, which is Jesus Christ. Straightforward, your foundation, Jesus Christ. Mm-hmm. Now, if anyone builds on this foundation with gold, silver, precious stones, wood, hay, straw, each one's work will become clear. So now he's giving an illustration. He's saying, we've all got the foundation of Christ, you're all saved, but you're going to build stuff now in a spiritual sense. Are you going to build stuff with gold, with silver, with gems? Or are you going to build with wood, hay, stubble? What happens to wood, hay, stubble when it gets burned?
It's gone.
It's gone. Disappears, right? That's the illustration that he's giving here, is that we're all going to be, we're all building something. Our works matter. We're all doing something, okay? But whatever isn't done properly is burned up, loss, okay?
Right, and you see the contrast here because he talks about the foundation being Christ, but then he goes into talking about your work. And we all know that we don't work for salvation, work for like Christ to save us. So you see the contrast there. Once the salvation's there, now it's about what you're working to build onto that.
Hmm. Amen. You're saved. Now what do you do with your salvation? Exactly. That's kind of like the call of my ministry, I personally believe. I think T. Hood's got the gift of evangelism. He loves to spit the gospel at people. I do too. But I think my calling is, okay, you're saved. Now what? Okay, let's go. Let's do something. Okay, for the day, by the way, we believe the day is alluded to elsewhere in Scripture as the day of Christ. The day of Christ is completely different from the day of the Lord. Don't get those two mixed up. The day of Christ at least starts at the rapture, and it has to do with the Bema Seat Judgment. The day of Christ when all believers will go and stand before Jesus. Okay? Because it will be revealed by fire, and fire will test each one's work of what sort it is. If anyone's work which he has built on it endures, he will receive a reward. Notice, though, what the Bema Seat Judgment isn't. Okay? This isn't where we're going to get up there, and he's going to point out, look at all this wood, hay, stubble. Look at all this stuff you're doing wrong. Jesus isn't going to sit up there and bash us, right? This isn't a condemnation. It's just burned up. It's gone. You receive nothing for it. This is more, the Bema Seat Judgment in this context is more of a reward ceremony. Mm-hmm. It is going to be a very exciting time. Now, once again, though, you got to be careful. Does that mean there's going to be no, I won't say heartache, but there is going to be disappointment at the Bema Seat as well. Mm-hmm. What's the main disappointment going to be? The realize of loss of time that we had. What are we doing with our daily walks? When you get up to heaven and you realize, that when we see these realities ultimately culminate, we're like, man, I worried about this. I did that. I didn't witness to this person. I didn't do this and that. You know, those are little things that will show remorse. But luckily, not luckily, but thankfully, Jesus will wipe away all of our tears.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. If anyone's work which he has built on it endures, he will receive a reward. If anyone's work is burned, he will suffer loss, but he himself will be saved, yet as through fire. That sentence right there is mind-blowing. Okay? Because I always wonder, what does the Christian look like who gets saved, yet as through fire? You know, who's the Christian who's going to get up there, they have nothing to show for it, they get through the Bema Seat, and they're like, whew. You know, what does that Christian look like? I don't know. I personally think it's somebody who probably hears the gospel call, truly repents, truly gets saved, truly has the Holy Spirit open their heart. They trust Jesus even for a moment. But how many of you guys know that even after you get saved, we still have free will?
Mm-hmm.
Okay? And you still have to daily die to your sin, daily take up your cross. So, I'm all about, you know, the emotional response, get somebody saved. Cool, that's great. I personally believe they get sealed. I personally believe that a lot of people will be in heaven that even just trusted Jesus one time. It's a judicial act, deemed not guilty the second you trusted Jesus Christ. But if they have nothing, imagine just getting up there and having nothing to show for it, and you spent your whole time down here not getting sanctified. Okay, notice there the word in red, work, okay? The Greek word is ergon. I know I don't maybe enunciate things very well to you guys, but over and over again in these seven letters that Jesus says, each one of these seven churches, he says, I know your works, okay? Any Christian who tells you your works don't matter hasn't read their Bible, okay? Your works don't matter in order to earn your salvation, but what you do with your Christian walk does matter, okay? Your works do matter, okay? Jesus, to every church, says, I know your works, ergon, 14 times in the seven letters to the seven churches. Do you guys see why we're spending so much time on these seven letters to seven churches? He knows our works. He knows everything that we're doing, ergon.
By the way, if this passage seems familiar, it's because we've gone over it many times, because mm-hmm. it's so relevant to the whole I know your works. And I mean, it's the most clear picture we have of the Bema Seat. So it's going to be of utmost relevance to basically all seven letters. So we'll probably go over it again in the next letter, I'm sure, just to keep reminding you guys of how important this is.
It's funny you mention that, because every time I'm preparing these lessons and I say in my heart, God, I've already taught him this. Mm-hmm. God lays it on my heart. I think I need to hear this mm-hmm. all the time. And not only that, but how many times in the letters do you read Peter say, or even Paul say, I know that I've kind of said some of this stuff before, but it's good for me to continue to say it to you. How many of you guys know that it's good to hear this and be reminded of this stuff? Kind of relights your fire. Okay, it's okay to reteach doctrine. We all need it. I've been studying now. Literally, my life is encompassed in studying. And I will go back and reread something that I studied 5 years ago, and I have to relearn it all again, you know? So that's okay. What you got?
I was just thinking, I was drawing a picture in my mind about, you know, the Bema Seat, everybody standing in line, and there's this one guy, and he comes up there, and then he's like, you know, of course he trusted Jesus, you know what I mean? He lived his life like he just drank beer every day, mm-hmm. never went to church, never did nothing for anybody else, just mm-hmm. lived his life, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
And then he's going to be like, wow, you know, when he gets to that reality and there's no reward for him, and then the next guy comes in line and he'd been, you know, doing all this stuff for God, working and doing mm-hmm. charity work and helping the homeless and all that, and he's going to have all these rewards. Well, if he was that guy that saw this guy behind him get all these rewards and see Jesus go, good job.
Yeah.
And here, and then he throws him back at Jesus' feet, and there's this big ceremony, but yet he's over here in the corner going, I just drank beer the whole time.
Exactly.
You know what I mean?
That's the kind of remorse.
It's gonna be pretty sad.
That's exactly the kind of remorse I talk about. We joke around and we'll say stuff like, for instance, T Hood or Derrik we all have like a group text message. We text each other all day with different spiritual things and things that are going on in the shop. And some T Hood will say, hey, I just witnessed to this person, blah, blah, blah. Or I just got somebody saved. And then we'll kind of make jokes like, hey, I hope I get to come to your mansion in the kingdom. You know, kind of like showing like I know that what you're doing is building kingdom stuff right now. I hope my mansion is as cool as yours. Mm-hmm. Okay.
Yeah, Chuck Misler likes to point out the verse in Revelation where he talks about Jesus wiping away all our tears, and his question is, why are people crying though? Like,
right.
It's a picture of the remorse. Like, it's you realize that I wasted my time.
Okay, and think about the drunk guy. Okay, think about this. He's going to finally, ultimately realize, okay, that Jesus guy that I trusted in is real. Okay, hell is real. I just spent my entire life, and I didn't tell any of my friends and family. Imagine, that's why Satan is so active against any believer today, okay? Because once you're saved, but if he can get you out of the game, you aren't going to save anybody else. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
That's why if he can get you to be a carnal Christian, not effective in ministry, not actively telling people about Jesus, he's won. Even if you're saved, he's already won, because then you're not going to go and carry out the flame.
So do you think that drunk guy is part of the wilderness and gnashing of teeth? Is that?
I personally think so,
yeah.
But a lot of people don't.
Yeah. What do they think it is? What's the other perspective on that?
Most people think it's hell.
Oh, really?
A lot of people...
That we can see hell, basically?
Listen, teaching on outer darkness, the outer darkness is actually a very controversial teaching, okay? I'm in what would be considered a minority view in that I don't think that outer darkness in the context of certain times that it's stated is talking about hell. I personally think that outer darkness has to do with millennial perspective. Outer darkness also, if you study ancient Jewish texts, the Shekinah glory is the brightness of God, okay? There are some teachings to the ancient Jews that the outer darkness was away from the Shekinah glory of God. There's all kinds of teachings I could give you on that. So personally, I think that the outer darkness that's spoken of in certain key verses has to do with that they won't have an intimacy with Christ. The carnal Christian will not have the intimacy with Christ that those of us who do walk sanctified lives will have in the millennial kingdom.
So it's kind of like a level of heaven.
Yeah.
So like the third chapter.
Unfortunately, one of the greatest objections to what I'm teaching you is they'll say, well, that sounds like Christian purgatory. You know, that sounds kind of like one's... So in the millennial kingdom, for 1,000 years, if a Christian doesn't get to experience all the things, isn't that kind of like Christian purgatory? They'll say, well, that doesn't sound very good. They don't get to do the things with Jesus. And I'm like, yeah. I mean, it's not necessarily purgatory, but I promise you for 1,000 years, you're going to realize that what you did with this little speck of time that we have right now mattered a heck of a lot more, you know?
Exactly.
So for that 1,000 years, it will be a lesson. And how many times in Scripture do we read that God chastens those whom he loves? Right? That's going to be a chastening. If we aren't faithful down here and we don't get to experience, I don't know about you guys, but I want to experience a lot with Jesus in the kingdom to come, everything that I can. Okay, so that's why I exhort myself to this. I need to be more focused on kingdom matters, not earthly matters. You know, this is a constant tension. I don't know about you guys. This is a constant tension that I live in. How much am I living for myself, for my job, for this, versus how much am I living for the kingdom? That's a constant tension for me personally. Is it you guys or am I up here alone?
Yeah. And another thing is that just one lifetime wouldn't be enough to know Jesus. You know what I mean? I'm looking forward to this life so short. You know what I mean?
You're telling me you think 1,000 years is going to be enough time for us to even...
Jesus forever after that.
It's going to take us 1,000 years for him to teach on the 7 letters that he wrote. That's how deep it is. Okay? Okay, anyways, so I know your works. Your works matter, right? Revelation 3, verse 1, our letter to Sardis. I know your works, Ergon, that you have a name that you are alive, but you are dead. They have no works, nothing good said about them. They're dead, okay? Continuing on with our Bema Seat theme. Therefore, we make it our aim, whether present or absent, to be well-pleasing to him, for we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, that each one may receive the things done in his body. Do you hear that? Done in your body, okay, according to what has done, whether good or bad. Are you bearing good fruit or bad fruit? Because you're going to be held accountable to it, okay? Knowing, therefore, the terror of the Lord, we persuade men. Terror of the Lord. Work out your salvation with fear and trembling. Fear of the Lord is the beginning of all wisdom, okay? Knowing that we're going to stand at the Bema Seat judgment of Christ, your works matter. One of my favorite life verses. And now, little children, abide in him. Abiding means continually stay in unison with him through your Holy Spirit. Stay abiding, okay? Continue abiding. That when he appears, we may have confidence and not be ashamed before him at his coming. How fascinating is it to think about that there is going to be Christians who are ashamed when Jesus comes back? That's fascinating to me.
It's terrifying, too.
And terrifying. They will be ashamed when... I mean, how many people... Well, we won't. I don't got time to go off on a tangent. There's a lot of Christians today that say Jesus isn't coming back. Okay, that, oh, well, they say that this... People have been talking about this for 2,000 years. If you heard on a daily basis, even Christians who like... Bible-believing Christians say, well, we can't know, and all the Christians have been saying Jesus is going to come back for 2,000 years. So imagine if Jesus comes back right then. They would be pretty ashamed at mocking someone who's actually excited for Jesus to come back. My defense, whenever anybody gives me that excuse, by the way, is good. I'm glad that Christians for 2,000 years have expected Jesus to come back. They're doing their job. And I'm glad that people have scoffed for 2,000 years, because that just edifies those of us who are truly walking by the Spirit even more. I love it when people mock the idea that Jesus can't come back.
It's a fulfillment of prophecy itself.
Yeah, that's second. Is it Second Peter?
Yeah.
2 Peter 2. Yeah, I'll say, well, thank you. You edified my faith today because you are fulfilling Bible prophecy where Jesus said that scoffers would come. Okay? Finally, Revelation 22, verse 12. When we ever get to the end of the book of Revelation, Jesus says, and behold, I'm coming quickly and my reward is with me. Okay? Guess what? Unbelievers aren't getting a reward. Okay? There is no reward for an unbeliever. So Jesus is coming. He's once again talking about this Bema Seat Revelation. By the way, according to his work, yes, you're right. That's the word ergon, and it's the law of last mention. It's the last mention of works. Okay. So anyways, why did I bring all this stuff up? Our works matter. Okay. He who overcomes, a lot of these promises to the overcomer are going to be realized at the Bema Seat Judgment. Okay. Now, here's my question. And this is where we're going to end with. And this is just, that's perfect timing. I didn't even get into the book of life today. But this is what you guys are going to have to think about. Okay? So once again, don't even look at that yet. He who overcomes shall be clothed in white garments, and I will not blot out his name from the book of life, but I will confess his name before my Father and before his angels. Okay? That's a set of verses. You can't pull one of those out. Okay? You got to leave those together. That's a set of promises that are, once again, a reward. Okay? Are you guys following me? So we talked about all these works mattering at the Bema Seat. They're a reward. Okay? There are many who teach, they'll take this, I will not blot your name out from the book of life. They'll automatically default to say that you can be blotted out of the book of life for basically living unjustly. Or you can be blotted out if you're a carnal Christian or whatever. Or you can be blotted out of the book. We're gonna look at whether you can be blotted out of the book of life or not. But here's my point. Think about this for a second. We know that salvation is not a reward for works, right? Has salvation ever been a reward for works? No. Saved by faith through grace. Saved by faith through grace. Okay. So why would we lose salvation in the future for being overcome? Let that sink in for a second. Okay? So a lot of people want to take this verse and they'll say that you can lose your salvation based on this verse. Okay, I'm not even making an argument that you can't lose your salvation. Okay, this is a whole side issue, but I'm just saying you can't use this verse for that. Okay, think about it. Once again, if we know that salvation is not for works, so why would we lose our salvation in a future sense? Why would you get saved, okay, and then at the Bema Seat lose your salvation for your wrong works, right? Does that not make sense? You guys see what I'm saying? So, something to think about. And that's just an initial observation. That's before we even get to this book of life. Anything?
Michael Heiser says, you can't lose through immorality what you didn't gain through morality. So,
that's
kind of the point he's making here.
Did you guys hear that? Does that make sense? You can't... So, like, and I don't think that's the argument, okay? The argument about loss of salvation, I don't think... Anybody who believes that you can lose your salvation, I don't think that they believe that you can, like, sin away your salvation. You know, like, do too many sins and then lose your salvation. Most who say you can lose your salvation hold to the view that you can basically renounce your faith, mm-hmm. right? Actively say, I want nothing to do with Jesus. Whether you lose your salvation at that point, that's a whole nother side study, right? So, you don't have to worry about crossing a line and sinning your way out of salvation is the point.
So it's like almost like you could cross yourself out, but Jesus won't cross you out.
We'll talk about it.
Right.
There. By the way, this is going to be a deep, deep study. This is going to get very fun. But it's also going to be very enlightening, because by the time you get to the end of it, I think it paints a beautiful picture. And I don't want to tell you. I don't want to spoil it. But it's really good. I'm going to pray and get us out of here, because Brandon wants me to have you guys out earlier. I get in trouble. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much, God. Thank you, you know, even just for today. I don't know about these guys, but I am exhorted to take your will seriously. I know that what I'm doing today matters. Every day that I'm here in my flesh, I get a chance to earn eternal rewards, and I get a chance to focus on you and your kingdom and the age to come. Help us all in this room to be heavenly-minded, Lord, and not just earthly-minded. We pray that you would enlighten us as we continue to study your book of life, and let us to know and be sure that our names are written there and that they're secure in you. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Enjoyed our presentations or felt led by the Lord, please feel free to donate at esfirst.org.